Hey everybody, welcome to Hoffman Oncology. Hoffman Oncology, part of ExcellaBio.com. Podcast, YouTube channel, Facebook channel, blog. Dr. Hoffman's also on LinkedIn. So there's many ways to reach out to him. And we're doing a very special interview today for a group of patients, right? There's a group of patients that are very educated and well-versed on breast cancer. And so a lot of the topics in this interview might go over my head, but it shouldn't go over the heads of these people in this group, because some of them are even doctors, okay? And they're very knowledgeable about this, and they have a few questions for you. So first of all, hello, Dr. Hoffman.
Hello. Hello, Dan. How are you?
Good. Excellent.
Nice to see you. How is clinical trials guru doing?
Busy, creating content daily, also doing marketing for other doctors like Dr. Bruckner, who's one of the PIs for ExcellaBio on Bruckner Oncology. We're actually doing something that's never been done, at least not as far as I know. We're following and documenting principal investigators in an oncology study for the first time ever, from study startup to study closeout, and we're going to see all the intricacies of what a PI goes through in a study, without getting into study specifics, of course, but we're going to talk about concepts. Like, for example, study startup. The site needs to get trained before they can even screen a patient, and we have a patient coming from overseas. Not everyone's trained. What do? It's a mad scramble. This is the day in the life of an oncology researcher. So I'm very excited about that. And we're going to be talking in some of our interviews, Dr. Hoffman, about the same kind of thing, because you're very much involved in research yourself with ExcellaBio, with Hoffman Oncology, with some studies that you are actually sponsoring and PI, right? So you do it all. And there's going to be lots of exciting content to bring you. But this one's very specific and very special for a small group. But I think we can broaden it. You know, you can get into the technical details. And then I will, because I don't know much about it, ask you in layman's terms to translate what you just said. So I'll stop you here and there when I'm confused. But
absolutely.
F1 testing, genomic testing in general, and its benefit to breast cancer patients. What do you think about this?
So, you know, let's think about, first of all, this young lady is talking about is next generation sequencing. Next generation sequencing, because obviously people have been sequencing the DNA for a long time. Next generation is because now we can do it that much faster, so much so that some of these laboratories are able to turn around very detailed, complicated information within 10 days. Something that would have taken in the old days a year and a half to do. So, and they're doing it every day for thousands of patients. And the idea really basically, if the genes are the place where the cancer comes from, and the DNA is always intact and something happens to break it, to cause damage, you will have this fingerprint that you can find again when you go and look at all the different pieces. And, there is an idea that, and it could be that it's a oversimplification, but there may be a very distinct group of genes that are consistently involved in making the cells into cancer. So, for instance, out of 20,000 genes in the whole genome, the genome being all the genes in a person, it's possible that only a few hundreds are for sure involved in the cell developing into a cancer cell. And the names of these genes are something called KRAS, NRAS, KRAS. A famous one is ERBB2, ERBB2. That's the gene associated with it, with a thing called HER2NU, HER2NU. And that was the famous first targeted agent of a drug called Herceptin. That's been I think on the PBS Cancer Discovery, there was a whole piece of it was dedicated to how Herceptin was discovered and how it changed the life of breast cancer patients. I mean, it is just unbelievable. And that is what we're talking about here. That's a targeted agent, and the reason why it's helpful is because there is a mutation, a genetic change in this medicine is specific for this particular target, and therefore it works in the patients who have that target, and it doesn't work in patients who don't have that target.
What do you think about, so how does this tie in with immunopharmacogenomic
Oh,
profile and combination therapy?
I threw that word in there.
Okay, so
It's not a real
it's
word.
not related. So what
It's
combination
not a real
therapy?
word. It's a combination of things because if you think about it, really, that's where we want to go. And I think that the what is exciting to me and what I always try to confer to everybody around me is the idea that we are at an inflection point, as this young lady mentions, because of the fact that really immunity, pharmacology, genomics, all coming together to develop in the development of a whole new generation of drugs, which is the first time since the 1960s, since the day that an Italian group developed a combination of chemotherapy to give to patients with lymphomas, from which the first combination chemotherapy for breast cancer was developed. And since then, this is really now we're in an age of change. Like we went from mustard gas at the beginning of the century to combination chemotherapy over, it took 60 years to do that. And I think now, since 1960, is about 60 years soon, we are going to have immunopharmacogenomics.
The word you made up, but maybe it's foreshadowing of something coming. And
Yeah.
you think it is. So, would you think this is any thoughts you have regarding a possible cure for stage four breast cancer? Yeah, there's
I
people
think
out there asking.
it's not only there, but it's palpable. And we have seen that already. I think Herceptin was the first, but I think that we're seeing now, if you look at the literature, there are it's we're just beginning, but it's a beginning that has really taken on a tremendous momentum. It's very hopeful for all the patients who have stage four breast cancer, which many of them have suffered together with me as their doctor, we are able to really pinpoint in some patients novel new drugs, maybe even drugs that are already approved, that can make such a difference. And I think that something that has been going on for a few years now is the FDA approved certain drugs called PARP inhibitors, in cancer of the ovaries, PARP, PARP inhibitors, in patients who, not just patients who have the mutation in an enzyme called in not only just in patients who have the BRCA mutation, but also in patients who have what is called loss of atherozygosity, which means that the cell has a tendency to make a lot of mistakes. A lot of mistakes as it copies the DNA to make from one cell to make two cells. It makes lots of mistakes, and these mistakes make the DNA of the cell sensitive to this drug, which inhibits the enzyme which repairs the mistakes. Mm-hmm. And although this is now FDA approved for ovarian cancer, the truth is that this loss of atherozygosity occurs a lot in breast cancer, and especially in triple negative breast cancer. And what I have been doing already for a number of years is to use off-label this PARP inhibitor in patients before the patients have surgery. They receive 12, 14, 16 weeks of two chemotherapy drugs plus the PARP inhibitor. And in the patients who have loss of atherozygosity, I've seen 100% cure.
Wow.
And that is unbelievable. I don't have survival data, and obviously I did not publish this information because it's...
Can we do a study on this? Do you think there's a formal way we can do a study?
So I have been trying to get a certain pharmaceutical company to agree to a particular twist on this project, and I connected a number of years ago to a doctor from South America who came here to, like I came from Italy, she came here to try to make a difference. And she has made a career in a very quick period of time in a very important pharmaceutical company. We don't have to say what it is.
Mm-hmm. No, please
and,
don't.
And this very special person has... learned everything there is to know about this particular science, and I believe that together with her, we're going to be able to write a protocol that's mm-hmm. going to look at possibly one drug chemotherapy plus the PARP inhibitor, and very interestingly, another drug made by the same pharmaceutical company, which actually has an effect on something totally unrelated to loss of atherozygosity. But the combination of the two cause a tremendous amount of damage only to the cancer cells. So they have, I didn't invent this idea. My idea is to use it in patients before they have surgery so that we can document what it is that is happening at the tumor level in the tumor microenvironment, because this particular approach could actually be step one of the immunotherapy component, right? And this is where this combination of things comes about, so that if understanding the gene, the genetic makeup of the cancer, we can develop drugs, we can have a pharmacogenomic, meaning we can have a drug that's specifically targeted to those genes, or the truth is pharmacogenomics is really about metabolism, but you can look at it that it's also about using molecules to target certain genes, because in some patients, whatever, I am using it in a context that's a little bit different. Like I said, I make the word up, but So if we can do DNA damage, one of the outcomes of that is that the cancer cell is going to either express new antigens that may be available to the immune system to kill it, mm-hmm. or the process of cell dying in the tumor microenvironment may create an inflammation status, a situation of inflammation, which the immune system may be able to use against the tumor. Because what we are seeing in breast cancer, as opposed to, say, melanoma or lung cancer, is that there is really a lack of penetration of the tumor by these T cells, which are stimulated to kill the cancer, right? Hmm. So the same drugs that we're using in melanoma are able to stimulate the T cells, the cells of the immune system, which kill the cancer. But somehow the tumor microenvironment is preventing these cells from coming in and doing the killing. And that is why it's so important to understand the tumor microenvironment. And
the tumor microenvironment?
Right. So the tumor microenvironment, it's like the neighborhood where the tumor cells live.
Okay.
And it's composed of the regular connective tissue, the gel of the tissue of the organ, plus a lot of other cells, including cells of the blood vessels, cells of the immune system, cells that support other cells, like the fibroblasts. And all these cells have an interplay. They communicate between each other. They interact with each other. Some of them secrete certain substances which favor the growth of one cell versus the other. And these cells are also the cells that, in a paradoxical way, prevent the very body to attack something that is trying to kill it.
Yeah. So this is extremely complicated. So the step one is the chemo and the PARP inhibitor. Then you get the issue of the inflammation, which is the immunity aspect of this whole thing. And then you've got the tumor microenvironment. Is there anything else we're missing?
Well, so what you want to do is, let me just say that targeted therapy is just the beginning of a combination approach to cancer, because I think that the targeting, as we are seeing, works for a period of time and then it stops. So we want to use targeted agents to cause other processes, because I don't think a lot of these targeted agents have in the general population are going to have a long, prolonged time of response. Eventually, the cell has so many different pathways of surviving. If you block one pathway for a while, the cell suffers, but then eventually they compensate with something else and they're able to survive without that particular targeted pathway. So either you start to target several pathways, or you go and target a very central area of the cell metabolism, which is hard to do because obviously that centrality is shared with normal tissues, and then you know, obviously you
that poses the challenge.
Right.
Yeah.
So what I think the better approach is to use that short window of opportunity where you come in with a targeted agent, cause either a change. Okay, so the players are the microenvironment with all its components, the immune system of the patient, and the cancer cell. So you want to cause a change in the cancer cell at the targeted level, which will in turn have an effect on the tumor microenvironment. And that will be the priming effect for the immune system to come in and do the killing.
And now, how do you help the immune system do that? Is that with the chemo and the PARP inhibitor?
No, so the immune system is helped by this new class of drugs called checkpoint inhibitors.
Ah, checkpoint inhibitor.
So the...
And this is a new class of drugs.
Yes, it's a new class of drugs that's been around. It's primarily being used now in melanoma, lung cancer, kidney cancers, but it's lots of other diseases will be amenable to this type of therapy. And what a checkpoint is basically just another receptor. It's another protein on the surface of different cells. And both the immune system has these receptors, as well as the cancer cells, and as well as the cells in the tumor microenvironment. So what is interesting to see is that there are so many of these checkpoints of these particular signals, and we have basically hundreds of them, or maybe that's exaggerated, but a lot of them, and the pharmaceutical companies have made incredible progress in identifying this checkpoint in a checkpoint markers, developing drugs against them, and primarily it's been about developing antibodies, like Herceptin is an antibody.
Antibodies, yeah.
An antibody is a molecule that is commonly found in the bloodstream of everybody. It's what we use to fight viruses, and it's also the antibodies are the things that cause allergies, some allergies. And these antibodies can be made in the laboratory with an old-fashioned system. It's old-fashioned now, but it's been one of the key biotechnology steps mm-hmm. in development of the new drugs. The ability to take these cells that become immortalized, they survive forever, and they are the same cells that produce the antibodies in a person, and they can produce the antibodies in a receptacle, in a container, and that's how you make antibodies against diseases, mm-hmm. all kinds of antibodies. So there are lots of checkpoints and lots of checkpoint inhibitors, and these drugs have the ability to turn on the immune system. Right now there are a dozen or so around, but there are going to be a lot more.
Yeah.
And some of them affect what they're called the T cells, but there are going to be antibodies that are going to affect all the different cells in the immune system, the macrophages, the B cells, the T cells, and all the different type of cells that the immune system uses to kill the tumors or fight infections, for that matter.
So
checkpoint inhibitors have been very successful in curing patients with melanoma, a disease that never had a cure, but they have not been so successful in breast cancer. And I believe that the answer is going to be, we are trying to answer that question with a protocol, a clinical trial right now, that's giving these checkpoint inhibitors to patients who have advanced but not metastatic breast cancer. And they get the checkpoint inhibitors before they have surgery. And this is a tremendous, it's the only study out there like this, and in the world right now. And we are looking for 20 patients who are interested in being involved with this, because what we're going to learn is is what is happening inside the tumor that's preventing these drugs from working. And I believe the answer may be quite simple, even though it is a very complicated environment. I believe that there is a cell called the macrophage, the tissue macrophage that's inside the tumor area, that is preventing the T cells from coming into the tumor microenvironment. And I believe that there may be an easy way to get around that. Obviously, this is not going to work for every patient, but like everything, but it will open up a whole new area of clinical therapeutics involving these tissue macrophages. And that would be a tremendous help if we could make a movement on that. So obviously, there is not just a ray of hope, there is a great deal of hope, because then these drugs can be transferred to patients who have metastatic cancer, breast cancer. And obviously, this is really the goal because there are still, unfortunately, most patients who have metastatic breast cancer go on to die. And in my mind, it's unacceptable, and we have to do our best to prevent that from happening. So these new discoveries of the recent few years, I believe, are going to make such a big difference. Now, we started out talking about the testing that's done for the to find out the target. So this is basically a blood test. The same test can be done on a piece of the tumor tissue, but today the same type of test is being used, can be done from a sample of blood. And what they are looking at is either little pieces of DNA that are that were produced in the tumor and now are floating in the bloodstream, or the cancer cells themselves, which are found in the blood, or a very interesting thing that not a lot of people know about, which is a byproduct of cells. They're called exosomes.
Exosomes, yeah.
And
I feel like we can do an entire video on
y'all. We
the
will, and we will. Not only that, but we're gonna get a very good friend, a colleague of mine from Italy to do that. But this
Ah,
exosome, yes.
that'll be great. Let's do
These
that. You should be
exosomes
both
are
on at the same time.
okay. We
That
can do
would
that.
be even better.
So
I can
what?
minimize my screen and have you guys own more of the screen real estate.
Oh, so whatever the source is, you can find traces, the footprints of the cancer inside the blood. And therefore, and some of these companies that are doing this type of test are fantastic. I mean, they have such, not it's not just the technology, because all you need to do this testing is a machine that can cost anywhere between from a few $100,000 to a couple of $1 million. Obviously, these fantastic companies have the more expensive machines, but the machine is not enough. You need the intelligence of both the experience, the data that you have accumulated, and plus the smart bio data scientists that are able to analyze this huge amount of information and be able to tell these little signals apart from the background. And the reason why this is so important for stage four breast cancer patients is because obviously when a lot people are now doing checking for targets in the original tissue biopsy or surgical specimen that was obtained 4 years before, that tumor that's afflicting the patient today, the cancer that's afflicting the patient today, it's not the same tumor that was removed at the time of surgery. Those cells have mutated, or a special subset of the cells has been able to resist the treatments and has outgrown the other cells. So much so that, for instance, some patients who have estrogen receptor positive breast cancer at the onset go on to develop metastatic breast cancer of the triple negative variety. Or it could still be estrogen receptor positive, but the actual receptor is mutated. And you can find that on the liquid biopsy. And there are plenty of clinical trials looking at very, very well-tolerated drugs, which are used to attack the mutated estrogen receptor. I don't want to say that they have been very helpful to a lot of patients, They have the same kind of problem that after a while that you've been on this drug, you become insensitive to it. But certainly it's something that we've never heard of before, to be able to have a targeted drug against the estrogen receptor in patients who are refractory or irresponsive to anti-estrogen drugs. So with this liquid biopsy, we can have an in-depth assessment of these cells, the DNA, the RNA, the proteins that are inside the cells, and then be able to understand a little bit better what are these cancer cells that are floating inside the bloodstream of a patient with stage 4 breast cancer. And what is fantastic about that is that we have lots of drugs that are specifically targeting these mutations or these abnormalities in the cancer cell. Unfortunately, a lot of them, even though they are approved, they may be approved for another disease. So you have to be willing to go to an oncologist who has the willingness to work with you to find ways to obtain these drugs off label for you.
You have to go to a Dr. Hoffman or a Dr. Bruckner.
Yeah, well, no, just, there are plenty courageous, valiant oncologists out there
you
that
know what?
All they care
That's
is
a good
do
one.
The best for patients.
That should be, because this rabbit hole goes deep. I'm writing down our next, and this will be a teaser for everyone watching. Stay tuned next week. Are you off next week? All next week?
Yes.
So
you
the week
talk
after.
About,
the week
you
after.
You want to talk about whatever, anytime. You want to talk about off-label using of drugs?
Two topics. Yes, that's part of it. So
we better consult the legal team.
No. It won't be about that. It'll be how to find a good oncologist.
Oh, you know, okay. In certain communities, there are organizations that are managed by lay people. Mm-hmm. That in New York, this is a very common thing. These community organizations are very good at chasing down doctors, finding out what they're doing, and following up with the patients. And they have been in many instances, an incredible opportunity for patients, because they can do things like organize traveling, finding out about the clinical trials. And I think that we need a lot more of those type of things. And I'm mm-hmm. actually talking to a patient of mine, a Bronx native, who is a breast cancer survivor, and I will help her get together a team of people to do exactly that. So that when somebody gets a sarcoma of the leg, they don't end up in a place where they've never seen sarcoma of the leg, and instead they can reach out to either a tremendous physician or a place where they have a clinical trial for that particular disease.
Yep.
This is a big problem in some communities, underserved communities. They're underserved because not because the government doesn't spend enough money on them, because they do, it does. They're underserved because the money that is being spent is being used by well, let's not go into
yeah,
that.
That's video number 3, maybe, or number 35. But Dr. Hoffman, thank you. If anyone wants to reach Dr. Hoffman or get information on the study, you go to hoffmanoncology.com or you go to excella-bio.com. We'll have links underneath. There's also a podcast. And go listen, because the podcast is Excella Bio on iTunes, on Stitcher, on Google Play. If you don't like to watch videos, you can just listen. And you not only will hear Dr. Hoffman, you'll hear Dr. Bruckner. You will hear guests, colleagues of these two doctors. We're also adding a third, Dr. Rafiq, right? And so there's tons. We're going to have tons of content for you guys. So Thank you very much, Dr. Hoffman.
Dan, I want to just mention the fact that we didn't get to talk about a lot of in-depth things, but we will the next week.
Part two, part three, part four. There's going to be so many.
Yeah, I want to be able to really give out some practical. Oh, we did cover a lot of practical information, but I want to go into it even more deeper, and. Since you are being conducted the interviews, I just want to tell people how what kind of an incredible person you are.
Oh, thank you. Appreciate that. Very kind of you.
Guru is you are innovating in so many areas, and that's what we need. We need innovation at all levels: clinical trial management, development, the ability to do things for less money, to get more people involved, because that's how we're going to, in a world of technology, we have to cure cancer in the next 3 years.
Wow.
We have to. Well, it's not going to happen 3 years, but we have to try very hard.
And we have to get further. Yeah.
We must.
Too much. And we will. We will.
We will. We will.
Thank you, Dr. Hoffman. And a lot of people are going to have a lot of homework to do. And then stay tuned. Part two next week. We're going to do it. And then we're going to have them all the time. So stay tuned, everybody. And thank you again. And we'll see you next time. Bye-bye.
Thank you. Bye-bye. Thank you.